And I think then we can maybe get there.
Well, that could actually be a thing. A few minutes ago, we saw Jankos on stage trying to go Super Saiyan.
Yeah.
I am not making this up. He was communicating this to in the lobby. He was screaming and yelling. And we'll see if the man on your screen on the left there goes Super Saiyan today. Because right out the bat, some targeted bans. Syndra for Febbithin and Talon taken away from Nehyun.
Yeah, Nehyun plays that a lot in solo queue and even on the stage. It has a limited impact, so I think they're actually doing Origin a favor. Because while the Talon, it can technically take off, it requires some team play, especially on split lanes, to make that champion work. Because you really want to find like isolated opponents, right? And I feel good macro teams will just ward out Nehyun, deal with him, and the remaining part of Origin never seems to kind of get to the same part. If he steals all the kills, then the other guys kind of just get beat up in a fight every time.
Yeah, what is the rest of Origin going to do? And H2K's macro has been pretty good most of the split.
Yeah.
Pretty good.
It depends if you're, if your definition of macro includes like late game team fighting and Baron setups.
Touche, touche.
Which should...
in which case then be more specific in my definition. How H2K have played the map has been pretty good. We'll see what level they come at today. Because of course, yes, that second seed in their group is available. And a series win here will guarantee second. It should be the result that happens, and only the inconceivable will throw us out of loop. First pick, what do you think? Because there's no real surprises yet. At least Malzahar, Lulu, the final.
If it's like North America here, it's an Insula Graves. Sadly, we're not there. We brought one of them over. One of the traders, Froggen, he's on the desk right now. But yeah, the meta is pretty diverse, and it really depends on what the team has prepared. Like in older times, you would go Rengar here, but people have been so willing to trade it for like whatever on a jungle pick. There's a case to be made here for maybe like an Ashe early you could go to, you know, if you really want that kind of utility AD carry. I think the Rengar is a fine choice, but by no means is it like miles ahead of any other pick.
Yeah, well, Tabs has played Ashe a couple times in the past, so maybe they could take that on this rotation. Rengar, no real surprise, and I feel like there's going to be a lot of Anivia hovers today with, you know, one of Europe's best Anivia players on stage on the analyst desk. And there's that Ashe, as you mentioned already, Crepo.
I think Ashe Karma could actually be a good rotation here for Origin because it removes any semblance of skill of the lane. you just play push all day. And the thing is, though, we need to see if Pekka's arrows have improved, because I still remember Pekka AD carry. Oh, no, it's no longer Pekka, it's Tabs. If Tabs' arrows are actually better than X-Paco, because the Paco arrows left a little bit to be desired.
They did indeed. It's been a little while since he's had the opportunity to shoot those arrows.
Support Ashe does exist, though. It's a thing.
I mean, you know what? It backs against the wall. Origin, this game is... what was the word the analyst desk used? This is a scrim, a bonus scrim ahead of the promotion tournament. Origin don't even get to pick their opponents. It'll be Giants that'll select whether they play Misfits Academy or Fnatic Academy.
Yeah.
And then Origin just have to deal with whoever's left.
We're the opponents, but right in this series, right, Origin can work on the foundations, the communication, just the game flow.
Yeah.
Like, they don't need to beat H2K, nor are they hoping to, but they want to put systems in place that they can then take over to the next series, to the scrims, and then hopefully win. So far, they're drafting utility bot lane with kind of a perma-pushing top laner if the Rumble doesn't end up in a jungle for some whatever reason. So it's definitely... It's a quite readable and playable game pattern, you know, that they can do. Like, top lane wants to push, so jungle should end up there to cover. Bot lane can play utility, and then obviously at level 6 on Shen, you'll have to rotate and go into the Shen lane. That is, like, exactly Origin already know what they have to do in the early game.
All right, now let's see if they can do it, right? Because,
yeah.
Like, you make it sound very simple, Crepo.
Problem is H2K also know that Origin want to do this.
There we go. And, of course, for H2K, they've got nice, strong sort of lane AD carry and Varus. They've got that sort of EU... heavy favorite top laner Shen, still like really high priority here in Europe, and Synchrov is going to lock in the Rek'Sai, so at least there'll be some kind of quasi-global response as well.
It's quite surprising though to see that Rek'Sai come out when there's so many other jungle opportunities available. I don't even think you need to pick it up that early. I mean, Origin really want to leave their mid lane pick last, I guess, for the counter pick, and they want to cater their support pick to the composition, but like, why do you need to rush Rek'Sai here? I think you just rush your favorite support here instead. Because, like, who's going to ban out Rek'Sai in second ban phase?
Well, that's, yeah, I mean, that's a good point. And you talked about supports. So Karma's off the table. We're not going to see Ashe Karma. Zyra was banned away. Malzahar's and Lulu's gone.
If they ban Zyra, they should ban Tahm Kench, because I really like Che on Tahm Kench. I think he's a really smart player when it comes to Abyssal Voyages. He also has the laning synergy with Nuclear to really get through any of those matchups. Top Kench is technically melee, but he provides so much zone, both with like spitting out creeps or saving people with Devoured so that Nuclear can actually play further up, that it becomes quite a strong lane.
Not going to be banned away by Origin. Would you pick it away?
I mean, let's see what he's playing against, right? If somebody gets Varus ulti, jumped by Rengar, taunted by Shen, these are all valid scenarios where Tahm Kench could help you. You pair it with an Ashe who has decent lane presence on her own. So definitely, there's a case to be made for picking Tahm Kench. Can Peke play it, though, is the question.
That is an exceptionally good question. One game played in the past.
I see you looking at your pick of Banshee checking. Just because he's played it.
I know.
Doesn't mean he can play it.
I just like to see if he's been brave enough to play it on stage, because that's an indication that at least he's willing to try.
Yeah,
right?
Will he uninhibit the Ribbit?
And we're going to find out, because it's potentially there. H2K elected not to ban or missed a ban.
Very rarely,
smiles on the faces.
Very rarely do people elect not to ban. They might tell us they elected not to ban, but then once we go into the comms, they were very much so discussing a second ban. So,
well, the Ribbit is uninhibited, Kench unbenched. Peke, how good is your Tom? Because of course, Che, we know how good he can play. With a champion pool so heavily targeted, where does Che look to next?
I mean, what's left? You definitely don't like playing Thresh in Tahm Kench, because it feels like you get damned if you do, damned if you don't. So some ranged poke lane is definitely something you could go for.
Like Brand?
Yeah, like Brand.
That's pretty fun.
Ooh, I love Brand, man. There's this insanely cool combo you can do. Somebody did it at All-Stars. I don't remember who. I know Doublelift told me about the combo, because you can Q Flash on Brand. Basically like an RE charm flash.
Right.
You can also cast your Q first, and then while it's mid-air, you can cast your E, right? So the way Brand's stun works, they need to be on fire for you to stun them. And obviously you don't want to put them on fire with your Q, because you need your Q to hit off. So you do Q, while it's mid-air, if you're at a certain range, you can pop E, and then you can stun them. Now you can combine both Q flash into the specific range, while Q is flying you E, and you really can get surprise stuns out there.
Now, is that just for flashiness,
no,
or do
no,
you
that
think
is actually,
real
that
world
is like
scenarios?
Laning outplay to the extreme.
Laning outplay to the extreme. Che, we're going to be looking at your lane. We're also going to be looking mid lane, because it's Katarina versus LeBlanc.
I've only seen two people do that combo. In a game. One was at All-Stars, the other one was me on my stream after failing it 20 billion times. But I did it! I made it once! So, definitely a fun combo.
Okay, so fun combo. Right, so we're gonna look if Che's gonna be potentially
yeah,
making
potentially.
That play.
I don't think so.
What do you think of Nahyun? Last pick, Katarina. It was the, you know, option.
It could be the sprinkle that we need. I'm not a big fan of Katarina here, nor in general. But it could be just what the game needs. It either has to snowball into Oblivion downwards, or he just needs to take off, you know, and carry the game solo. And I think Katarina is exactly a pick that could bring that flavor.
Ooh, that flavor indeed. Craziness in week 10 here at the European LCS. This is the last time that Origin will be playing their last series of the split. Will they go 0-13? That's what we're gonna find out. Nahyun and Katarina. That might be what's going to help Origin out here, pull off a gigantic upset. It's quite an interesting pick and ban.
Oh yeah, we don't see Katarina very often. Rek'Sai jungle when the likes of Kha'Zix and Lisa are open means you're cheesing or you're digging deep or you're uncomfortable.
Or the other direction, you're going super comfort. Synchro has played a lot of Rek'Sai.
Yeah, but you're uncomfortable on the main picks, right? And you go back to like a comfort pick that is out of meta.
There we go. All right, that makes sense. Comfort pick out of meta for Synchro. This is something he played a lot in the LVP and last year as well, in previous seasons. Let's see what he can do with Origin as we load up between H2K and Origin. It is, of course, Group B starting off the day. And as always, laning phase can have a gigantic impact in the game. It feels to me like the bottom half of the map will be pushing towards Origin. H2K and the advantage, is that about right? Mid lane,
yeah.
Bot lane.
I feel these color roots, they're coming back.
I'm really not trying to nurture them. it didn't work out too well for me.
Yes. It took about 2 years to have just people forget. Just a whole new wave of fans come in, like Quickshot. No, he's playing that play. No, yep. He never used to be a color.
No. It's the new guys that I appreciate.
The new dawn, the new day. No, I think you're definitely right on the money there, Trev, because a Brand Varus lane has all the potential to shove. Luckily, if Che ever oversteps, Tahm Kench is actually quite powerful kind of duelist potential if he can actually use Devour offensively. So that forces people to play a little bit at a distance, and Ashe is quite high range and can like CS with volley. So if Tabs and Peke manage the lane position right, they shouldn't lose too much farm. But H2K will always be in control. And especially if Sinker starts in the top side, what you'll probably see is Che again go for that grump ward that he does so often. You know, push bot up, get the grump ward, and suddenly Origin is playing kind of revealed on the map.
That'll help Jankos on this Rengar, especially in the early stages of the game.
I think Jankos just did it. Yeah, he just took, he went to the... You see how he has two stacks already? He used the Blast Cone to get two stacks. It's a little cool gimmick you can do. You jump, the Blast Cone is, was actually southwest of where he is right now. He jumped on it from the brush. And then I think he leapt in the air and pressed W, whatever, and then you get two stacks, and then you can start the camp, and you can do actually much more sustained clear in the jungle, because you get the four stacks faster.
So well, it looks like,
usually Rengar's drop really low in the jungle, but this little gimmick keeps you much more sustained and can actually catch people off guard.
Do you think Jankos will use it? I mean, if you look, there's CC in literally every lane, so options available if Origin decides to push, maybe Sartorius, the most obvious?
Yeah, it's more if you end up in a duel in a jungle. It probably won't matter. It's a slightly faster clear maybe, because obviously he's doing kind of Korean clear. But because of the... if there's a ward being placed soon by Che, they like to see that blue buff is still up and he can actually go for the counter invade. Because Synchroff is doing a path that has been very commonly done recently. It is basically Raptors into red into enemy blue, and it's to punish junglers that do exactly this Korean style clear. But obviously, as metas evolve, this counter has become so stale and so meta that Jankos actually just knows that the enemy blue buff is still up. And the counter is kind of played out in itself.
So instead of being a steal, it just ends up being a trade?
Yeah. And more importantly, this is done between two pushing lanes, like you just pointed out. So it's very safe for Jankos to do this path. And that begs the question, with that in mind, should Synchroff maybe kind of change it up here, you know? Like, if the enemy really... thinks you're going for this play and suddenly Jankos arrives here and the blue buff is gone, then obviously Origin could have caught them off guard. This is how you can kind of use patterns to your advantage.
Yeah. But then you have to know that they know that you know that they know, you know, in terms of anticipation and preparation.
It's the same thing when lane swaps were kind of played out every single game the same way. You could do what's technically stupid, but it will work because nobody would expect you to do the unexpected.
What was that quote? How can I be expected to, you know, hit my skill shots if the person I'm targeting doesn't even know what they're doing to try to dodge it?
No, it's the great I'm Cuniba. If I don't even know what I'm doing, how will they know what I'm
doing? There we go.
Lord Santana.
Yeah.
May he ever return to the LCS.
He likened himself to Shrek. I don't know if you read that interview with him.
It's a great interview.
It was fantastic. A lot of personality on
his streaming schedule, and then we go back on topic, is actually super, like, impressive to be that consistent over many years. I think people always... paint them as a bit of a goofball, but like to be that dedicated to your work is honestly very impressive. Now back to the game.
Okay, back to the game. We have pushing lanes down bottom. Nuclear and Che going to be shoving into Tabs and Peke.
All right, let's see, Tabs. How well do you guys see us together? Peke takes the heat.
Well, that's that a lot of heat. Not good, Peke. He eats an entire combo.
Tabs got the CS, though.
Okay. Do you call Worth?
If my AD carry says, like, can you hit that for me? And I'm like, I don't know, man. There's like a pyromancer on the other side. He's a bit of a zombie. Don't mess me up. It's like, gotta get the CS, bro. And yeah, he bases.
Well, that just, that stinks. I mean, Tabs is already down two waves of CS.
I mean, he has technically a wave coming. That's like the play-by-play cheating, you know? Oh, this guy down. Well, look at how quickly he's catching up, Trevor.
I think if he gets all of them, he's still gonna be just under 12. So I tried to factor it in. Close enough, there you go. Yeah.
And he's not even getting them all, is he?
Look at all the pressure from Nuclear. The piercing arrow. 10 CS. Less than two. But now there's some
fake
shenanigans
news.
In the mid lane. Che's gonna be in trouble.
Nahyun.
Flash forward from Nahyun. Comes in and gets first blood. Escapes with a dagger. And
run,
the
Nahyun, run!
Here comes Jankos and Febiven. Ignite starts to tick him down and Jankos secures the kill. We've got a sprinkle of Fiesta.
We asked for it and that's exactly what we need. Che goes mid. He loses flash. Exhaust. Nahyun still gets the first blood. He forces Jankos to flash in and then Synchroff gets the acceleration, and now this Origin comp is getting much closer to level 6 as well, where Synchroff will have a global, eventually expecting if he stops eating those raids, we'll get to level 6 too, and then we can really start spicing up the map. And Che basing next to the wall, that's really greedy to do versus a Katarina. Should always base in the middle of the brush here, and then Nahyun spacing out pretty well. He wants to walk to one dagger, Jankos is blocking it. This flash from Jankos gets punished very well. Synchroff here, pulling the trigger. Flash back up.
Nicely done. The comfort of Rek'Sai. Getting that unburrow, helping get a kill and assist under his belt. And I mean, if it were me and it was solo queue and Katarina got first blood, I'd be triggered already.
I mean, if you're Febiven and you say in team chat, guys, I have enemy mid 20 CS down. I'm winning my matchup. Your support comes mid to roam for whatever reason, dies, and enemy Katarina comes back with a Hex Drinker. That's when you gotta think a second before you say the next thing that's on your mind, because it may actually be quite disruptive between team comms.
Communication has actually been a topic with HTK all split long, hasn't it? In terms of some of the decision-making, some of the team fights.
I feel bad for Febivan. This guy is demolishing his opposing lane matchup exactly as he should, punishing the range advantage. You know, it's essentially a shotgun champion. And then he gets a kill and an assist, and he comes back with Hex Drinker, which counters the kit of Obong entirely.
Well, let's see what Nahyun can do with this little gift from H2K. Because, I mean, at the end of the day, he's kind of going to be one of the pivotal members of this team.
Yeah.
There's some CC from a lot of the rest of the support squad. Sartorius can have some big impacts. I mean, Sartorius is a super comfort champion as well. This is the 8th time he's played Rumble.
Yeah, this is super teamfight oriented by Origin, and this could actually be one of HTK's weaknesses. If you remember, Unicorns in week 2 or 3 drafted like a Katarina Ivern comp, only 2 damage dealers. And the whole point was to kind of suck HTK in and then have Exile pop off in the Katarina, and exactly that happened. So they have shown weaknesses against this very this pick in particular. So the dream is still alive.
Yeah, the pick and I guess the playstyle, right? The way it extends, the way you have to play around a Katarina, try to enable her hopping between those daggers. We obviously have a pause. I will let you guys know what the cause is in a moment or two.
Oh, well, Oduwamne just ran off stage.
So unfortunately, Oduwamne's feeling a little under the weather. Febivan doesn't seem to care.
All right, the Hex Drinker doesn't matter as much. Talking to the ref right there.
Yeah, technically speaking, within the instance of a pause.
I don't think you're allowed to talk.
Correct. And I think that's...
Unless the ref gives you absolution.
Yes.
The ref giveth, and the ref taketh away.
The ref in this situation may not have giveth.
Yeah, probably not.
Probably not.
There's actually quite a few old refs that are now my colleagues. And they always have... whenever they instruct new referees, I've met a few people who are in the new referee program. It's like, yeah, Raven. Raven's our old... old ref, and they tell me, you know what? He gives us one example of the most horrible, like, smart-ass player that there was ever to deal with. And if you can deal with him, you can deal with any player on stage.
Just for interest's sake, who might this player be?
Ah, slips my mind.
You know, I mean, there's
Ravishy
been
Handsome,
few...
Belgian is all that I was described. great Nvidia player, but I just can't put my finger on it anymore.
Is it awkward, though, when you first transition to being a shoutcaster from player? You know, we got a bit of a retro desk today with Froggen backstage as well. Mm-hmm. And seeing refs, guys that technically could, you know, tell you off or provide guidance depending on your point of view.
I mean, my straight superior all the way up to esports food chain is somebody who I vehemently insulted in season 2. Like, how the hell can this pause happen? But yes, darker times.
I think that time was justified, though. Uh-huh. That was a pretty spectacular moment. For better and worse in League of Legends.
Anyways, you have your hand on the table, which means you want to talk. Do you know what the pause is about?
The pause is about Oduwamne not feeling very well.
Okay.
He will be returning soon. I assume he's just going to get a splash of water and whatever else is necessary. In terms of this game, playing Shen, is that maybe what's put Odo a little bit...
If it was Soas, I'd be like, yeah, no, I think we got it. We're playing Dr. House here, you know? Is it Lupus? No. Oh, he's playing Shen. Yeah, no, okay. I think we found the main cause. I mean, at least Shen, you can move your pretty little dagger around. If it's like a Maokai or a Nautilus, maybe then you just get like...
Yeah, I'm done.
You pass out, yeah. Right? Your brain goes on 10% activity, and eventually you go into like a flat state of relaxation.
Oh, flat state of relaxation. Origin squad, super chill.
I never found that to be good. I feel like whenever players did this, it feels like you would lose your focus. You know, if you just lean
but
back.
But it's each to their own, right? Like, I personally don't like leaning back on the chair. It's uncomfortable for me. But some people enjoy it. Some people are chill.
You also have a rather large head, so like center of gravity may pull you backwards and
my
tip your chair.
My hair is heavy. There's a lot of product in this stuff. It's the reason we stand up. You know, we have to support the weight of the makeup in the hair and
you would tip over.
Ups. Yeah, I would. Absolutely would. Is it Senkaks from Splice that goes like all the way back? I think he goes like practically horizontal.
Some of them do.
Come on, Tabs. That's not comfortable. We're breaking down the mechanics of laying on the chairs right now.
Yeah, I mean, it looks pretty comfortable.
Okay, I mean, that's an upgrade, right? The hands.
That's where you ask the ref for a pillow.
So, Crepo, if Origin lose today, 0-2.
Yes.
Nothing will change for them, but they will have, in the same split, broken the longest game losing record at 14 losses, and they will have the worst EU-LCS split of any professional team in the history of EU-LCS. Those are not two records that the man on your screen right now would want.
It's definitely not what you sign up for. You make an organization, you get to Worlds. You go in Challenger. You have that really nice house in Tenerife, it was. And you progress, and it just doesn't really work out.
It does not work out, unfortunately. While we wait for the game to resume, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to send it over to the analyst desk for take a look at what's happened in this early game.
I was just talking about...
Thank you very much, guys. Unfortunately, Oduwamne is not feeling too well and stepped off for a second, so we're just waiting to see what happened there.
Frogman will step in.
We have him here now.
You want to play Shen?
No, that's boring.
No. All right, so Frogman, we're going to get the picks and bans up on stage, up on the screen, rather. Talk to me about this European draft and how do you think both teams did?
I think the only thing I really mind about is that they chose to ban out Syra and then pick Tahm Kench blind instead of just picking Syra blind and then banning Tahm Kench. I don't know if it's because they want to contest it or not, but it's better just to pick Syra because it's a stronger champion.
Especially also because we were looking at there's a Shen, that's got Varus, that's a super strong laner. Now you're going to give them, support pick as well on the side of H2K. They can pick, so this case, Brandt, who's winning lane against Tahm Kench. Yeah. So you're now going to get shoved in the bottom lane 24/7. There's going to be a Shen ulti coming your way at some point as well. And then you're going to lose that bot lane tower. And then the game is going to kind of snowball in favor of H2K.
Well, we have to keep in mind that Peke is, of course, quite new to the support role. And Lulu was banned out. Karma was banned out. What he usually goes for in this scenario. So maybe...
He's an old mid laner. He should play Zyra.
He should play
Zyra. I know.
Zyra.
When I played EU solo queue, Peke would always play Zyra support.
Right, was also
so he definitely played.
Yeah, he banned Zyra.
Oh, right. Good point. That
Which
was
is not
point.
A banned Zyra. He's taken the Zyra.
What? Yeah.
I think if you look at it, it's like they could have had a really good draft where they counterpick top, they can counterpick mid, and they can blind pick support and just ban the other supports out. And they could counterpick the jungle too, like every single jungle except for Elise was open. So they could have winning jungle and three winning lanes, but they chose to go with Tahm Kench and then they have a losing bot lane against Shen. It doesn't seem smart.
Doesn't make a lot of sense.
What about some Katarina mid lane?
I mean, it looked fine. I think the skirmish they had didn't really go well for her and then she's down in CS.
We're gonna take a look at it actually.
Yeah, I think for the skirmish it's just it's fine. But
see, I hate these kind of recalls.
Yeah.
Just please, you don't know if there's a ward there. Just step
still,
away.
It ends up being a good trade despite losing first blood because of the amount of creeps that Nahon will lose. Obviously, there's a lot of jokes going on about that. Well, I will never lose creeps for these kind of players, but this is just not good for Nahon in the lane matchup. He will fall really far behind, basically losing 2.5 minion wave, and it's just not a good situation.
He was already pretty far behind, so I think for Febiven it's just a bit frustrating, though, because he comes back and he still has his Hex Drinker coming back into lane.
It's fine. Most of the time, it's just about experience for the early levels in mid. Obviously, the gold will help a lot, and if he wasn't able to get the Hex Drinker, it would be a really bad situation for him, but falling behind, almost a level, I think.
Yes.
It's just a really bad situation for him.
And he basically got it, or he traded it for a kill on Rek'Sai. Because Rek'Sai obviously got the kill in the end on Jankas, and that was about it. So, tricky situation for the mid lane. Bot lane is going to die very soon to a Shen gank.
They are. Well, we will see. The players are already on stage and ready to resume the game. So, Quickshot and Crepo, back to you guys.
Thank you very much, Shox. Deficio there with some last little predictions. Bots
I feel
about
like
to dive.
South Park, they took our jobs. thank you. All right, I guess I'm out. But he actually does bring up a great point in Champions League. We talked about one of the things that Origin should predict is that on level 6 of Shen, you swap into that lane. You move towards the problem. You face it. But Origin, they're delaying their problems. They're just saying, if we close our eyes and sit down, put our heads in the sand, then we can just pretend the Shen won't ulti bot and dive us.
Hey, look, every monster that ever wanted to get me when I was a child couldn't find me under the duvet. Couldn't find me underneath the blanket. So if it worked for me growing up, maybe it'll work for Origin.
Yeah, but has it not left you irreparable damage. Psychological damage? Like, is that really what we want?
Well, I mean, you know, you start telling a story and I instantly get afraid. So, yeah, probably not the greatest situation. But as we look at the lane setup, Tabs and Peke, they've not swapped into the Shen lane yet.
Yeah. No, they're going back to bot lane. Obviously, the doomed official scenario can be counteracted if Sartorius can somehow poke around the out or look for a turret trade or a dive with Synchro in the top lane. But then Synchro needs to start tunneling really quick.
Okay, where are these tunnels? All in the northern side of the map, there's one in mid lane, nothing down bottom.
Oh, wait, what? Peke, Tabs is alone. Peke went to red buff to assist Synchro in taking it and is now walking back. Can we get the expected cam on level 4? Because he can't even ulti Synchro into the top lane. I'm quite confused as to what Xpeke is doing right now.
Let's see, maybe it's next level. Or maybe Tabs, maybe wanted to go top.
Maybe they were predicting the HK prediction. Saying, you know, they're gonna match our rotation to top, so if we don't rotate ever at all, we'll get ahead.
Well, that's exactly what happened with Tabs, although he's still down. CS. Is a wave coming towards him though, which Nuclear is busy shoving in. Still gonna leave him a little bit behind. I'm looking at the mini-map in terms of what sort of shenanigans can happen. Synchrov is in the area. Teleport's available for Sartorius, and he's got his equalizer.
Yeah, and look at the Yankos, level 6. He's going to do the Crux, it seems. Nope, he's just gonna... Yeah, he's actually gonna finish him just for a stack. Once he's done with the Crux, he can just run into the lane in bot lane, get the Shen ulti. Let's see if mid lane Feverman can get lane priority over Nahyun and leave. Then we could maybe see the bot lane party in full effect.
All right, let's take a look. Nahyun at the moment, down a very sizable amount of CS thanks to all of the combat in the mid lane. And down bottom, Tabs has got some support from Synchro. Che, maybe greedy with the flash. Let's find out. Chain of Corruption starts to spread, and Odo Stand United just saving Che's life.
Yeah, it's actually really good from Origin, forcing the Stand United in a defensive scenario, but also keeping the distance, not flashing in. Synchro wasn't quite in range yet to follow up and look for the burst, and just trading that ultimate for an arrow, and as Taurus has free reign over the top lane, there's no Rengar to punish him either, so he can actually start proxy farming. It's a good moment of reprieve for Origin, and unlike Deficio, I actually know what that means.
Nicely done, thank you, my eloquent co-caster for the day. And this is good for Origin, 10 minutes in. They've got this, like, breathing room, not having Stand United available. They've got Synchro with his ulti as well, so if Origin want to look to set up some plays, they can. The only thing they've got to try to cut back on, if you can use that word, like Nahyun and Tabs are bleeding CS. They're really struggling under some of the pressure of their opposite lane matchup, and like Tabs' tower, so close to being knocked over.
And now Che is level 6 as well, so if you're ever going to try and gank this lane, the problem is this Brand can turn it around. He's actually the major threat in terms of instantaneous damage. So definitely have to be careful if you're Origin, and I feel like they're eventually going to end up in a gridlock.
Peke, stop eating skill shots! 40% of his HP is just taken away. He doesn't even have any biscuits or cookies to regen.
Ate them all.
I mean, Tom Kench is good at eating them.
Sometimes you regret it, you know.
Yeah.
Finish all the biscuits, wish you saved one for later. That's expected right now. Synchro still hovering around his bottom side. He's been here for over like a minute and a half at this point. Looks like they're waiting for the second arrow, and they're going to pull the trigger.
All right, arrow. Che, this time round, flashes. Last time, maybe knew he had the Stand United.
But that's 2 minutes spent for Shen ulti and a flash. Now, expect it's even more damage.
So much damage. Peke can't even get the gray health down. Che and Nuclear make it look so easy.
Yeah, he just disappeared. That was incredibly, like, non-committal, I think, from Origin. Greedy pathing, too, in the lane. With the Tom Kench, Tabs didn't pop his heal at all, and it seems like Origin, the fire we were expecting, you know, a little bit of fiesta that we wanted to be sprinkled on it, it's not happening. Yeah. It's also a vitality scenario almost, where they're trying not to fail rather than do something and fail in the process.
Playing to not lose necessarily. Yeah. That soft gank, it ends up costing Peke his life. And of course, HTK get tower first blood. So that's a 2,000 gold lead already.
Yeah, now they can't even rotate into the top lane because they need to catch that wave. So this is what you always want to do when you're an AD carry. You want to, after every positive action where you win out, you always want to push out. That is your main goal. Don't ever stay and sit on that gold. It's a mistake a lot of players make in the early stages of the game too. They get a kill in lane and they, oh, you're stronger, right? No, you just have more gold than the other guy.
Yeah.
Maybe a bit more experience. You probably chunk too. So to get the maximum benefit, you always want a base, and the best efficient base is always after you push out. Because not only does it reset the wave, it forces this guy to farm close to his turret, and then he has to walk out in the lane towards you, and you can farm safely under your turret afterwards. And again, that's what Tabs is dealing with right now. He got the wave pushed into his turret, it bounces, he can farm maybe three waves, and then he's very much so overextended.
Yeah, that risk of being jumped on, especially when you see that ward just to the left of Tabs. Stand United's available for Odo. Jankos has got access to his ultimate as well for a little while, and we'll see how good Origin's vision can be.
Nahyun
gets jumped on. I don't think he's in kill range yet. But the numbers you see on your screen right now. Oh, Nahyun's actually decided to engage. Looking for the kill. Stand United shield. That saves Fabi's life.
Yeah, it looked so good, right? Oh, you forgot about my combo. I'm Katarina. I deal so much damage. Oh, we're playing against the Shen. Quite unfortunate for Nahyun right there. All right. Now we can start talking. You wanted to talk to me about control wards?
I did, because the teams that place the most control wards per game are the bottom four teams. Yeah. And it seems the teams don't want to talk about this, though. Vitality far and away above everybody
else.
But I
want to talk about it.
Tell me why. Why do the teams that are performing the worst place the most wards?
Look, it's not about the size of your ward stack, Trevor. It's about how you place them.
Okay.
That definitely matters. And I think bottom tier teams, very much so when they're behind, like Origin right now, you know, not to this extent, but they want to start contesting their own jungle first. So when they have a lot of these control wards, they have to place them first in their jungle, and then they can get them into the ideal positions. There's a couple brushes in the map that are very high value in terms of placing control wards. Those are usually the pixel brushes in River, maybe in the Baron Pit. And if you're a team like H2K right now with a 2,000 gold lead, you can generally walk up to the point where you want to place them, especially later in the game. Early game, it doesn't matter as much, but we're talking like 20 to 25 minutes. They can instantly place them in the right spots, and they can also actively defend their control wards, meaning they don't have to place as many. Yeah. Losing teams, they always want to fight their way back in with vision because they never want to be spotted in their own jungle, so they just overly kind of waste control wards in their own jungle to the point where Vitality was spending like 1,000 more or 700 more gold than any other team just on control wards.
And what's terrifying about that as well, Krepo, both, all four of those teams actually have average to below average game time, which means they're placing more wards in shorter games.
Yeah, more wards per time.
Yeah. So that's really, really interesting. But when you're playing defensive, you don't want to face check, and that's what Origin are going to have to do. 1-3-1 initiated. Febervin's going to be down the bottom lane. He's got his proto belt, his Sork shoes. Nahyun can't stand toe-to-toe with him.
Yeah, and you have this Rengar as well, who's really good at lane ganking in any of these side lanes. If you're playing 1-3-1, you have the Shen that can appear everywhere. LeBlanc is kind of the perennial side lane mage, has always been that champion. Shay sidesteps, ooh, beautiful.
Oh, really nicely done. Didn't have flash available, but Shay, he's been tabbed as a target, and we're seeing Xpeki level arrows here.
Yeah.
Not finding success.
He was very far up, though. Without Shen ulti available, he was, I think he tried, like, he figured out that he didn't have flash as the arrow was flying.
A little bit of an oopsie. But luckily, Chase not punished for it. And Pekin needs to work on those sidesteps. It feels like every time he's under tower, Chase getting a WQ combo and just chunking him down.
Oh, Chase definitely getting him. Now Tabs gets cut out here by Nuclear.
All right, Pyroclasm not going to get used just yet. Nuclear is going to be happy with the flash heal and turn his attention to the tower. I mean, that's what they're playing for.
Yeah, but Origin is stuck. They feel like they can't move every step like they make. There's always somebody waiting for them from HK. Now Sinkov trying to fight his way out here on Jankos.
All right, Odo Amnes says, Jankos, I'm watching you. Jumps in with Stand United, a two-man flash taunt. Look at that, curving it. Odo gets a kill onto Pekin. Where is Sartorius? Looking to finish his teleports in a moment or two. Nahyun gets popped, takes one with him though. And now Sartorius, he throws down the equalizer. This is getting a little messy. 2-for-3. The Unburrow from Synchrop. He's going to give up the kill. And Origin get ace.
Yeah, there's no way back when Origin ended their fight. They just hard commit all in. Win or lose. Like, these guys, like, they were only down a member. And then they're like, yeah, well, we're fighting. We're fighting to the death every single time. The last part, why did Sartorius flash in there? Why did Synchrop follow? It's really grasping at straws. Again, this was the type of fight that they need. The taunt flash curve beautifully didn't actually connect with Tabs. Odo kind of leapfrogged him, which meant Tabs could bait him in. Now he's going for the long-range arrow. That's only useful if you actually play Teleport Ash.
Right. What you have with Tabs? Does he have some support? Gonna deliver Tabs as well. Fabi and Shay looking to run away, and they get Odo's teleport.
You get his teleport. If that arrow actually connects, that's a beautiful combo. Because this is something Season 1 Ash players did in the mid lane. They would send it from base, teleport on the mid lane turret, and then surprise them.
I did that too.
And look at it again. See, they find Jankos. So I like this. They're dragging a fight out 45. Right now, the teleport should come. Sartorius should be TPing already. This is one, two, three, four, five.
Still hasn't started, and he doesn't stop for another 6 more seconds.
6 seconds, guys. This is Origin starting a play, and it takes 6 seconds for the Rumble, who is walking down to mid lane, so he's watching this fight, to consider that maybe he has a summoner spell that gets him there ever so slightly faster. At this point, if you're Sartorius, you may as well run Ghost. And he knows.
Yep, that's the reaction.
And that's why he flashed in afterwards. He was trying to chase a loss. He knew he done goofed.
Too slow to TP. And that's both kind of like somewhat player error, somewhat team error as well, right? Because you can call for TP, you can decide to do it as well.
If it's under like 2 seconds, it's team error. But the guy was walking to mid lane.
Yeah.
He had vision on that fight. He knew the fight was going on. At that point, you just got to pull the trigger.
All right, Bebevin picked up a lot of kills that fight. He's got the Abyssal Scepter completed along with the Proto Belt, and that's why H2K are now playing just so aggressive on the front foot. Nobody can stand against that burst.
Yeah, now Origin just need to suck H2K in, find a team fight here, find a pick, just go. Balls to the wall aggressive.
All right, Stand United's available. Jankos is going to bring Odo closer to the fight. The target is going to be Sartorius. He's getting dropped low. Nahyun at least gets one back and under the tower. Jankos is caught out. It's going to be a little bit of a trade so far, 2 for 2.
Yeah, Nahyun is still looking for more. He is the prime target. If he can find more picks, he can maybe carry this game here. Expect it. Just playing bait, and he's really good at that.
He really is. Here comes Synchrov as well. No flash available in the Unburrow. Makes getting the knockup a little more difficult, and Febavin gonna look for those Shatter Orb damage. Not gonna be enough to kill PK.
Yeah, it's definitely not ideal, right? But they just kind of suck HTK into a bad fight and surprise them somehow. Make a little outplay here and there, a bad read. Get near here on a kill, get the reset. That's what they gotta do, because otherwise, if they play it slow, steady, macro style, HTK will come out on top. That's why HTK is looking for kind of solidifying their second place so far in the standings.
Yeah, gonna get that preferred seed, most likely against Fnatic in the quarterfinals. That's what H2K are looking to lock in. I mean, you can't deny the fact that a Katarina Rumble could be scary if H2K get caught by surprise or out of position.
Yeah, and here, like, they force a fight, Nahyun's coming down, and look at it, they catch the enemy AD carry in rotation. This is on the minimap, you saw him flash out, so Nuclear was watching the top lane fight, and that's what happens very often in chaotic games. People just right-click, watch the fight, and see where who's using cooldowns, like right here. This, he could just walk to around, right? Take the safe path, and then suddenly on top side, you're fighting a 4v3 on H2K, and you will win that across the map. The problem is if you keep even trading like that when you're not paying attention, that's the way Origin want to fight into the game. That's also how historically H2K have lost a lot of fights. Expect it caught again.
All right, how much damage is there to follow up? Bibovin jumps in, piercing arrow, secures the kill, and Peke used the flash for that.
And has exhaust available.
Feels bad, man.
Spackle's support career
so
hasn't really taken off.
We were talking about can Xpeke play Tahm Kench? I don't think Tahm Kench matters at the moment because he's eating skill shots. and I think regardless of champion, H2K are just punishing him over and over and over.
Yeah, Froggen made a good point on the desk. Just draft a Zyra. Froggen said it was because Zyra's a better champion. I would even extend that point. Just draft a Karma or a Zyra so you can play kind of AFK push style where you just focus on pressuring the lane and just adding an element of pressure to your team that doesn't require too much like individual skill. Yes, you won't get a CS advantage if you just push in and you let them farm on a turret, but at least you stay even and you keep the push going. Right now, this lane is quite hard to play if you're not in sync very well and if you can't sidestep banned spells.
And of course, the decision to pick Rek'Sai over one of those supports. Synchrov's Rek'Sai, like, he's doing okay in terms of the reactionary fights.
Yeah, right? I mean, he's 6 out of 7 kills, has 3 kills to his name. I don't think we can blame him for his Rek'Sai play.
Is it worth the investment of the damage of Pekka on Tahm Kench? Maybe that's also one of the questions you got to look at, right?
Yeah, but
being pushed under tower and...
Then you got to feel for Leduc, though. If you can't trade a Tahm Kench in this meta on your support because you're afraid he'll go down, then you have bigger issues than a Rek'Sai pick.
Well, yeah, there's quite a few issues to work through for Origin.
But there's hope, Trevor.
There is.
It's only 5,000 gold. Bigger comebacks have happened in the European LCS.
And internationally, and everywhere.
Everywhere. It's happened in solo queue, it happens all the time. All it takes right now is for Origin to write open, and then be like, ha, psych! It wasn't actually open. It was what they call an EU open in all chat.
EU open. I guess Katarina would be able to punish that pretty well. So, we'll see whether or not you can. Pekka goes for the optimistic tongue lash. Comes away a little worse for wear.
The best of tongue lashes.
A little worse for wear. As Jankos and Nuclear poke him out. Okay, H2K look like they're setting up for Baron. That has gone badly for them at different points in the split, and Origin have got a good team comp to punish that. Let's see, Jankos and Febiven, they're gonna chase between two towers and just force Origin away, knocking over their third.
Great rotation here by H2K, isolating the third and remaining turret. Can they get the Baron? That is the question. There's this one lone control ward that survived in the enemy jungle. That could be a teleport ward for Sartorius.
Yeah, we'll see how good his equalizer will be as well. And we've hit this point of the game, Krepo, where we start looking at teams and how well they farm side lanes.
Yeah.
That's what you're looking at on your screen. CS secured between 15 and 30 minutes. And H2K, they're actually pretty low down in terms of picking up the CS on the map.
Yeah, this is one of my favorite stats in the game because it's a little bit obscure. You basically count every CS taken by people from 15 to 30, and it just gives you an indication how many teams play on three lanes, you know, pick up on a side lane farm, and how many play on two. And then obviously you need to contrast to what are they exchanging for that. H2K is a team that you see Favon going to side lanes very often, but he'll just kind of peel off and join his team and look for picks when they play kind of these comps. Maybe when he's as far ahead on LeBlanc, he can push out further, but H2K, when kind of troubled, had this tendency to play more on two lanes in a lot of their compositions. Obviously, if they're playing a 4-1 comp, they're not going to split push as well, right?
Yeah.
But it's a good indicator, and you see that G2, the kind of the best macro team in the league, was very much so first in that category. Because in the mid game, they take it slower, and they make sure that they're always farming their side lanes, using that for pressure.
All right, so then, of course, anytime you're playing around objectives, grouping up, you start sharing CS things. But there was a little caveat, which you haven't talked about, Krepo, because on that graphic, it said it's excluding jungle creeps. So what about jungle creeps? How do you farm those? Who picks them up?
Well, would you know, there's another graphic popping up as you ask the question. Amazing. I think it's actually really cool to then contrast that to the jungle creeps, and you also see different styles. While Origin, they're not the greatest at farming their lanes, at least they aggressively contest their junglers. This was definitely in the Wisdom era very much so, more so than the Synchroft era. They were at least actively farming. And if you look at G2, one of the reasons their mid game was kind of slow and steady is that Trick was always making sure he was maximizing his camps. So he wouldn't just blindly play in only in the enemy jungle. They would play both in their own jungle, take the camps, then take the camps in the enemy jungle, and take small victories everywhere. A Gromp, a couple of Krugs here, side lane farm, and suddenly your gold lead from 2 or 3k amasses to 5k as you just squeeze the pressure out of your opponent, and then you can commit for Baron.
Pressure on the map as well as all the resources being denied. I want to talk about Jankos and how he picks up farm, if and where. If they survive this fight, Che once again easily sidestepping the arrow. Origin group up and Tabs is blown up before the fight really even starts. Now Synchrov and Pekka are running away. Sartorius has already cancelled his teleport because the fight is lost. El Capitan is down and Nuclear gets a double.
Yeah, this was a beautiful execution, honestly, across the board from H2K. Side lanes both were pushed. You look at the jungle. Only the red buff recently just spawned, which means H2K was maximizing their jungle farm. They were taking away the opposing jungle farm. They robbed Origin of all of their vision, and they themselves counter-initiated a Picketen by Origin because they were forcing them into a corner. This was very much so a forced error by Origin. As you could see, Odoamna landed in the fight before Sartorius was even halfway into the channel of his teleport again. So it's a 5v4 forced by H2K by just immaculate kind of macro right there. And it just shows you why they're a full class or a couple tiers even ahead of Origin right now.
Yes. A huge difference. I mean, Tabs, he got blown up in the middle of the melee instantaneously.
Yeah, but this is the where you pay the price for mistakes that you've already made. You know, this is credit debt right here.
Yeah.
Like, you've already done your online shopping if you're Origin. This is just where the bill comes in, like, oh, well, I guess we're going to try and pay that off. But then Che jukes another arrow. Really good at sidesteps, by the way. He gets the Shen ulti. Because he didn't get hit, he can flash out to buy time. Like, if Shay actually eats that arrow, he no longer has his flash available. They just one-shot him, and then Origin fight their way back. But it just means that they're making it too obvious. They need an arrow from Fog of War. Like, you can't have these wards everywhere. You need to de-ward, play with control wards, and surprise your opponent, pick them off. Not just start a full-blown, full-vision team fight, because H2K will win that.
And we talked about some of the warding earlier. Origin, one of the fourth highest at placing wards. They need to do a little bit more to regain some semblance of control. But it just gets, like, multiplicatively more difficult when you're down 10,000 gold, when you're down in towers, you're down in dragons. Now your opponent's a Baron. I mean, it's like, it's now up to H2K just to knock over the inhibitors.
Yeah, yeah. If you're Origin right now, you wish you could save gold for the next game. It's like, can we put this aside? I'd like to my emergency rainy day fund for the next early game, because it's looking super grim right now.
Yeah, it really is.
This is where you just deathball. You deathball and you just pick a lane and you say go. And maybe they're not ready. Maybe. And then you get lucky.
Well, where would the initiation be? I guess Synchro of an X pick here. Jumping behind somebody with less mobility than a LeBlanc.
I think you have Synchro going with Flash knock up somewhere, but you have Xpeke deliver Sartorius to a backline. And you just surprise Che or something.
Okay, let's see if Peke and Origin try something at least, because they've hemorrhaged everything else on the map. Gigantic CS differences for mid and AD carry. When you're not allowed into the lanes, that's, you know, quite naturally going to happen. And I think despite a little shall we say speed wobble from H2K, trying to ramp up in the early game.
A speed wobble?
Yeah, you know. Yeah.
Let's say speed wobble, yeah.
Where's
Despite
speed
that,
wobble?
Very much so speed wobbling that they were doing.
Have you ridden a motorcycle before, Mitch?
I had quads when I was growing up.
Okay, so it's kind of similar. If you hit the acceleration too quick in a low gear, like the front end kind of, you know, rattles and shakes around.
Yeah, mine were automatics and I was also nine.
Okay, okay. So. Okay, fair enough.
But I get the speed
when you
wobble
get to
point.
My age, you've ridden a few motorcycles in your time.
If I get my motorcycle before I'm 35 like you, I'll definitely know what a speed wobble is. But continue, your point.
The point was, other than the speed wobble, this has been a very clean game from H2K.
Yes.
They've had good vision control, they've played the jungle well. That was one of the best Baron baits I've seen in a little while.
I'm loving Che's sidesteps. This guy must be great
this,
at
this guy sidesteps.
No, the cha-cha-cha, you know, he must be... The hips don't lie.
All right, Febben, gonna look for Peke here. That's a big burst of damage down. It's just so tough. I mean, it's a 14,000 gold lead at 30 minutes. Ash Arrow this time will catch Che. Chain of Corruption goes wide and Nahin decides to engage. Stand United, not going to be enough to save Che's life. But Synchro's down, Nahin's down, and here comes Jankos. This is Origin's last ditch effort, but they're so far behind. Maybe H2K have overcommitted. Defensive flash from Febben.
Although I'm still not in the fight because he obviously was cancelled on that ultimate. Even then, it doesn't really matter. We see the two side inhibitors fall.
Yeah, 4 versus 5, and even though H2K look like they'll lose the fight, they win the war because they've got the inhibitors in top and bottom lane. They're not even done yet.
Yeah. Making Leduc feel not so great, but there's always a game two, right?
I mean, there is. It has to be a 2-0 for this to end. And Origin, they're on a 7-game losing streak at the moment.
They'll make it 8.
It will.
Will we see 9?
The expectation is yes. The expectation is we'll see 9. Surely. For the second time this split,
yeah.
9 losses in a row.
But you may put Origin at a 0-9 deficit twice, but nobody puts them on a 0-9 deficit 3 times.
Actually, somebody did. I'm going to quickly just double check.
They've
exactly
actually had
who
it already?
Was. Yeah, they have. They have, because Splice put them on 0-8 at the beginning of the split.
Oh, but that, including that one, you know.
Ah, okay.
Next time.
Okay, right.
Sadly, for Origin, they're very much so at risk of that being in Challenger.
Yes.
The way it's going right now. Because they need to make some growth here, like the fundamentals, like swapping into a Shen lane wasn't done. They have not made a single proactive Abyssal Voyage play. The arrows are not connected. It feels very disconnected. Even Sinkov, who has shown like shimmers of okay play, can't shine in a team that is so stuck in negative and bad routines.
Crepo, the two teams that are in the promotion tournament from LCS, Giants and Origin. And then you look at the two challenger squads, Fnatic Academy as well as Misfits Academy. Do you think Origin at this level will be able to beat either of them? Because you kind of feel like Giants maybe is a step above, but Origin just don't really feel like they have what it takes right now.
Yeah, but we said that last year as well when kind of Misfits was blazing through everybody, right?
Yeah, they struggled as well.
They struggled. Xpeke, he's done struggling. He can rest now.
Well, let's find out if he gets a longer rest period. The Pyroclasm comes up from Che. Gonna tag a couple of Origin members. He's gonna start backing away. The rest of H2K now looking for the Nexus turrets, waiting for those super minions to walk in. Sartorius. He's teleported in behind, looking for Nuclear, uses the Hourglass to buy time, and while he's golden, Nahion's killed. Sartorius follows shortly thereafter. H2K take down the Nexus turrets. There's no objectives remaining, no opponents remaining. With the ace and the base, H2K 1-0.
Yeah, and a good confidence boost here for H2K. They needed it. They wavered a little bit, obviously, on the one there was a tiny bit ill, so you have to go off stage. You know, that could also play with your emotions. So I think this very strong victory is is good for them because they're heading into playoffs. They're obviously not thinking just about this match. They're thinking about progression paths, facing strong opponents, and really getting the routine down there is what you need. Because you can't spend time refining the basics right now, because the good teams, they'll be ready to counter your basics.
And playoffs are next weekend. Yeah. There's no prep time, you know? Origin, this is their last series of the split today. And next Thursday and Friday, promotion tournament starts. Like, they've got 4 days from now, 5 days from now, to get their stuff together.
Their stuff.
almost. And,
I know.
And make it work.
I love it when we have pro players on the desk every time, and they're like, yes, they have their stuff together, and it can really mess with your head. Yeah. And it's a very... unfortunate situation.
It's difficult, but you know, I found another word. I found an alternative.
Yeah, you found it. You a minor speed wobble there, but it definitely.
There we go. Nice. You see, I'm glad I'm teaching you a little bit of you know, life stuff.
Here. No, but it'll still be a best of five under intense pressure.
Yes.
And as much as you can mock losing every week on stage here, Origin they're done dealing and learning how to deal with the pressure. These other teams coming in, this is everything they've been working for so long. If you then lose a game one. In a somewhat bad way, you can just go on full tilt. So I will never write off Origin in this promotion relegation tournament.
Yeah, we'll have to find out what they do next week. Before that, there's still going to be a couple more games. Let's take a look at how HDK have won the first game in the series. Shucks, what do you guys think about it?
Well, what do we think about it? HDK won, and that is what they had to do. But of course, we're looking towards how they are improving and what they can improve on going into playoffs just next week. And when we had the pause, you guys said, well, or you said, in 2 minutes... or in 1 minute even, there will be a gank bottom lane, there will be a setup. Mm-hmm. Shen will come and they will get a double kill, or a kill at least, and get that. However, HDK didn't set that up properly. So just to make them prepare for playoffs, what should they have done differently?
Well, Frank was talking a lot about this with like jungle support not really working together, syncing recalls, invading together.
Yeah, I think a lot of it is like, they show that they really want to set this play up. Like, everybody on the team is on the same page. We're like, okay, we're going to really make this happen, right, guys? But then it's still going to be this half-assed thing where it's like, okay, the support is recalling. Jungler just got done with the Raptors or whatever he's doing. So he's just going to follow the support. This is a boring time for the jungler, you know? It's like, oh, I need to follow my fucking support. And I can't farm. Like, what am I even doing?
Just set classic a double jungler, right? By the way.
Classic so jungler.
He has no wards. He has no pinks. And you have the support beside Stone. And he tries to, like, walk somewhere and put down some vision. But it's just not really done, you know? They get into river and then it's like... I gotta go back home.
I
gotta stop.
Yeah, I guess the issue is that this is something that is quite simple to set up, right?
Yeah, obviously another thing that kind of interrupted what was supposed to be that beautiful Shen dive was the fact that Syncroft went bot lane. Mm-hmm. So we saw the Ash Arrow, Che got hit by it, Shen used defensive ulti, which again stopped them from having the aggressive play on the side of H2K. I'd like to just see Che flash that one and then actually set up the play that Frog was just mentioning. But all in all, while we can sit there and say, yeah, this could have been done a little bit better, because of this Tahm Kench pick, the bot lane just lost its tower just on its own. They just lost tower. And then HDK went mid lane and started setting up in the mid lane with the AD carry and support. And that's where it was like Origin are now behind and they have to make like a big outplay. When they then got that one fight, it actually didn't go in their favor.
Well, let's take a look at that big one fight in the mid lane where HDK was setting up for. And I'm going to ask you guys, was this proactive or reactive? Because Jankos gets...
Well, firstly, I guess it was reactive, and then it becomes proactive, in a sense. But like, this was kind of the chance for Origin, in a way, to get back, but it's tough.
Yeah, I think there's a couple of issues with this play, because HDK is not really ready to fight it. Like, in the replay, you can see Nucleus walking back to the mid wave, and he kind of wants to push it in, and then we're going to make the play, expecting Jankos just to back out. But he gets the Shen ultimate, and then they obviously want to go for the play on their head, and there's nothing wrong with that. They're just like not really on the same page, I would say. And I also think from Jankos' perspective, he should have realized that, what's it called, Origin, they can't wave clear. He can just be in mid lane and use his ultimate when the minion wave is at the tower, and he can just sit in the ultimate, and then LeBlanc can flank. Like, they don't need to flank two people combined. Jankos can just run straight at them, and they can't really do anything, and it will still be a free tower. So to avoid getting picked off, they can just go together and just execute it.
Is there a world where this is, oh, we know we can do this and just sit here, they don't have any wave clear, we can push, or is this well, let's try the more complicated approach because we need some practice. Is that a possibility?
I mean, I don't think it was that like complicated for them. Jankas was sitting in a brush on the side right there. And they were probably discussing.
Super complicated, dude.
Like very complicated. I think another thing like we were looking at just to make it easier for H3K was like you have LeBlanc winning the side lane against Katarina and a Shen ulti. You can literally just go push in with LeBlanc and then say, Katarina, are you at your tower? Well, we're going to kill you now, 2v1. And then you can then take the tower, or you can then send the LeBlanc to mid lane, to flank, as Froggen was talking about, to force them off the tower. Like, there are very simple ways to do it. They didn't have to opt into a massive 5-on-5 fight between two towers. But that was also just reacting to Origin actually, like, trying to force that fight. I think there's in many ways as well, like, from talking to these pro players, like, when it's the top teams, especially against Origin, no offense right now, a lot of them are like, yeah, you know, we don't 100% prep it, we don't 100% sit and try and, like, fully execute what we're supposed to do. But that's just, you should. Obviously, you should try and play it perfectly because that's what you need to do against the better teams as well. If you make the sloppy plays against the better teams, you will obviously get punished.
Right. So what are we expecting here going into game two? Origin obviously was not able to show a lot. And the Rengar pick maybe for Syncroft, just put him on a Lee Sin, let him go ham and try and go ham, right?
I mean, for me, it's just I would just like to see them do it together. Like whenever they recall and they know they can make this bot lane dive, just have the support recall. Support and jungle recall, maybe even the mid laner, just so they come out base at the same time. You know the enemy team still has to recall. You just go up, set a vision, and then you just take the bot tower with a Shen ultimate. I don't think they need to be greedy about it. They just need to actually do it. It doesn't really matter if it works well or not. Like they're probably gonna win the game anyway. So they should just go ahead, execute it, do it as fast as possible, see what happens.
So if you're Origin, what can you do? Either you draft full early game, you know, you try and get like really strong lanes, especially bot lane, and maybe you try and see if you can like pressure H2K a little bit there, like Vitality did. Or there's the other one where you try and say, let's draft like a comp with like a tank top lane, some scaling, and then see if we can get to a late game without being too far behind. But like,
we're scraping at the bottom of the barrel here, it seems like.
You have won 2 games and lost 25 games. I think if you figured out now what to do, it might be too late anyway.
It's just in time for the promotion.
And if you know it, or I know it, or he knows it, then I think we should have told Origin like a few weeks ago because it's a little bit too late.
All right.
I think I have a few things they can do. Like, what it looked like they were doing is just the bot lane matches bot lane, LeBlanc goes to the side lane, and then Nehirin is trying to match the LeBlanc, but they already know it's not going to work, so why in the world are they doing it? They should be like, we have a Rumble that can use ultimate from really far away, like the range on it is insane. Rek'Sai has tunnels, it's really easy to flank. You have some Ken's ultimate that can just ultimate behind the mid lane, and you're playing against what's called Varus and Brand. And you have so many options to really just kill them in mid lane. You don't need to care about that tier 2 tower being up or not. Just use the Tahm'kent ulti behind them, have Nehirin stay mid, and just fight them. He hit a really good power spike, being level 11, and they can easily kill 3 people, even through Shen ultimate. They should just go for it, like, make some plays happen. Just don't lose.
Yeah, make the plays happen. I agree, let's hope we see that. As H2K has picked up game 1, we will see if Origin can make it happen and fire back when we return.
And now Sartorius, he throws down the equalizer. This is getting a little messy. 2 for 3. The unburrow from Syncroft. He's going to give up the kill, and Origin get ace.
Keep in mind they have Tahm'kench and TP, but I think we can block it out.
Alright, Stand United's available. Jankas is going to bring Odo closer to the fight. The target is going to be Sartorius. He's getting dropped low. Nehirin at least gets one back, and under the tower, Jankas is caught out. Origin group up, and Tabs is blown up before the fight really even starts. H2K, take down the Nexus turrets. There's no objectives remaining. No opponents remaining with the A's and the base. H2K 1-0.